Going to start.
A very good afternoon or good evening to you all, wherever you are joining us. My name is Dr. Alhassan Dettu Mohammed. I'm the chairman of the Nigerian Society of Anaesthetists Education Committee. This Sunday, we have a webinar where we have invited speakers, a speaker to talk to us on a very important area of our practice. Without wasting time, well, let me mention that this is the sixth series session number 9 webinar. So we have with us, we have Dr. Udeme Sese from University of Uyo Teaching Hospital, a consultant anesthetist, who will guide us through this webinar. She will be our moderator. Dr. Udeme, please, you have the floor. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dati Mohammed. Good evening, everyone on the platform. Please, I hope I'm very audible.
Yes, you are.
Hello. All right. Thank you very much, sir. I want to thank the NSA School and the Education Committee for giving me this opportunity. So, with due respect to all my seniors and colleagues on this platform, today we are having the 9th session of the 6th webinar series organized by NSA for our benefit. And today the topic is image interpretation for computed tomography, magnetic resonance imaging, and radiographs. Of course, you know this topic is very important to every anesthetist, from the patient you meet to anesthetize and to patients you manage in ICU. So to handle this very important topic today is one of our, he's actually an associate. His name is Dr. Eric Okechukwu Ume, a fellow of the West African College of Surgeons. He's a reader, a consultant radiologist of the Department of Radiology, Nnamdi Azikiwe University Teaching Hospital, Newe, Nigeria. He's also the president, Medical Research Society of the College of Health Sciences, Nnamdi Azikiwe University. So today we'll be hearing from him, but before then we need to have the ground rules, which includes that if you aren't speaking or recognized to speak, please do well to mute your screens and your audio. If you have questions, you can put them down on the chat box. Your question will be read out and addressed. And at the end of the webinar, if you have questions, you indicate you'll be recognized to ask your questions. Your questions will be duly addressed. And of course, if you are not satisfied, our speaker will always be available. You can reach him for more clarifications. Thank you very much. And now I hand over the floor to our associate. He is actually the son of one of our late professors, Professor Ume. So please, we hand over the floor to you, Dr. Eric Ume. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, moderator, Dr. Udeme. And thank you, distinguished listeners. I thank you for this privilege of my making this presentation this afternoon. Well, the first slide there is the gates of the Nnamdi Azikiwe University Teaching Hospital. That's our permanent site. Some departments have moved, not radiology. The place is still very much under construction. Like the moderator says, the presentation is image interpretation for computed tomography, a CT, magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, and radiographs. It was in 1895 that a German physicist and engineer named Konrad Röntgen discovered X-rays. It was a major discovery. In fact, he won the inaugural Nobel Prize in physics in 1901. So he made this discovery in 1895. But by 1896, physicians were already using the X-rays for imaging the human skeleton. And, you know, so radiology was born. For the first 40, 50 years thereafter, imaging was done just by X-rays. We introduced contrast studies, but it was still all about traditional X-ray imaging. And then we gradually, physicists, engineers continued to research on imaging and began to give us ultrasound in the 50s and 60s. By 1971, the CT was developed. And in the 70s and 80s, MRI. Now we have quite a variety of imaging modalities, from mammographies, tomosynthesis, and others. You know, in the practice of medicine, physicians are actually encouraged to familiarize themselves with some means of interpreting, understanding for interpreting radiological images. Regarding the modalities that may suit their specialties. In my center, resident doctors from other specialties rotate through radiology to acquire some exposure and experience. And then we have these interdepartmental seminars where radiologists participate, and then if there are radiological images for, you know, to be spoken about, they do that, and then we all learn together. Radiology plays a useful role for anesthetists and intensivists. You know, if we are either, you know, imaging the chest, the head, and neck to facilitate preoperative assessments of the chest and airways, or when imaging the spine, best done using ultrasound, you know, to guide anesthetic agents, and then inserting spinal catheters in children. Also, trauma CT, trauma MRI can be very helpful in planning the management for patients by the anesthetists. But generally, the role of radiology includes, number one, identification of the lesion, the pathology, if it is there. Determine the site, its location, its size, its shape, if it's a lesion, you know, its density or signal intensity or echogenicity or any peculiar features that help us to arrive at differential diagnosis or suggest possibilities. Now, having seen the lesion, we are to look for possible associations, which may be complications of the disease entity or the lesion in question. For instance, a plain radiograph may show an opacity in, say, the right perihilar region. And this opacity shows a shaggy outline and it's irregular. However, it's homogeneous. And then on the same side, we see another homogeneous opacity at the lower zone of the lung, and it shows a concave a meniscus upper border. And we see this opacity extending into the costopharynx sulcus. You know, so we are talking of a lesion in the perihilar region, and we are talking about an opacity, associated opacity in the ipsilateral lower zone. You know, these features will suggest, say, a bronchogenic carcinoma and an associated pleural effusion. Radiologists perform this interval imaging, you know, during the course of treatment. If somebody has been diagnosed with, say, pneumonia, there's a consolidation seen before treatment is started in one or the other of the lungs. And then after treatment has been completed, the radiograph is, imaging is repeated to see whether the consolidation has resolved or whether treatment needs to continue or change. Then we have image-guided minimally invasive procedures. We use ultrasound, for instance, to guide procedures like drainage of an abscess, drainage of a cyst, true cut biopsies, FNACs. You know, the guidance is so that we don't, in the process of carrying out the procedure, blind, damage a major blood vessel. So imaging helps us to protect against collateral damage as a result of the necessary procedure. Then radiology, we have the interventionist procedures. We may, for instance, want to lyse a luminal thrombus in the middle cerebral artery, or maybe we want to artificially close up a carotid cavernous fistula. You know, now we're able to insert a catheter into, say, one of the femoral arteries and move the tip of this catheter retrogradely to the through the external iliac, to the common iliac, along the abdominal aorta, all the way to the arch of the aorta. And then we maneuver the catheter into the common carotid of interest, left or right, and get to the spots, say, at the region of the cavernous sinus, where the fistula exists, and deploy a detachable balloon. So this is an endoluminal technique. Or we may go beyond that to the level of middle cerebral artery that's affected in the patient with a thrombus and inject a thrombolytic agent. So these are interventionist procedures. Then finally, follow-up imaging. You know, a woman has a breast cancer and has had a mastectomy. Yeah, she comes for follow-up imaging. We want to keep looking at that chest to be sure there are no features of metastasis or lymphangitis carcinomatosa. We want to periodically do a mammography on the contralateral breasts to be sure there's no malignancy developing there. We want to periodically do an ultrasound, abdominal ultrasound, to be sure no deposits are found in the liver. Because, you know, with interval, with periodic follow-up imaging, problems can be found early and attended to early. You know, but today we're discussing image interpretation for radiographs, CT, and MRI. So for each of these modalities, there'll be a little background physics, you know, a summary, you know, a short summary of the background physics, so that listeners will appreciate the means by which the image that they seek to interpret comes about. Because it's not really the way images are produced in ultrasound, that they're produced in MRI, that they're produced on CT, or even on plain radiographs. Then the advantages and disadvantages of the imaging modalities. We'll talk about densities, opacities, signal intensities in terms of which modality each of these are related to. We'll now talk about image appreciation, that is understanding the normal image in each of those modalities. And then talking about interpreting abnormalities in each of the modalities. We'll also speak on artifacts, image artifacts, that's anomalies on images that they are produced artificially, and they may mimic a pathology, but they're not real. You know, so there are common ones for x-rays, there are common ones for CT, and there are similar ones for MRI. And it's important to know at least the most common ones. So x-ray, the patient is exposed to x-ray photons. Now, X-rays are electromagnetic radiation, you know, and they belong at the high end, high energy end of the electromagnetic spectrum. And this radiation, that's energy in motion, exists in small pockets called photons. So you see, when we have X-rays produced by an X-ray tube, what we have is beams of billions of photons from that X-ray tube that are supposed to help us produce an image of the internal structures of the body. You know, so the X-ray photons are produced within an X-ray tube and focused on the area of interest, say, for instance, the chest. And these photons, you know, are produced in line with exposure factors. That is, the radiographer determines the energy that each of these photons should have, and even how many photons will be used to produce the images. So these things have been standardized over the over several decades. So we know, for instance, what energy, that's KVP, kilovoltage, should be used for producing chest X-rays. What should be used for producing chest X-rays in children as opposed to adults, or should be used for producing chest X-rays in a slim person as opposed to a big person. Now, the receptor for the chest X-ray, that is the film or the phosphoplates, depending on whether it's a digital or conventional procedure, is placed on the opposite side of where the tube is located. So the tube is located on one side of the body, and the beam is focused on the patient, and then the receptor is placed at the opposite side of the body, so that the radiation that passes through the patient can interact with the receptor on the opposite side. Now, when the X-rays are released by the tube, three things can happen when they get to the human being that they're supposed to interact with. The photons may pass right through the patient without interacting at all with the patient's atoms and interact with the receptor behind the patient or on the other side of the patient. The second thing that may happen is that the photons will interact with, you know, outer shell electrons, you know, of the atoms of the body, and will be deviated a little from their original course. So these photons like this are said to be scattered. You know, they still get to pass through the patient, but they don't go along their original course. They get to interact with the receptor on the other side of the patient, but they constitute a problem to the image formation eventually. There's a way that is attended to, which I'll mention later. Then the third group of photons will also interact with outer shell atoms in the patient. And they be scattered so significantly that they will not interact with the receptor, which is on the other side of the patient. So it's something like this. We have the X-ray tube, and then we have four described sets of photons. You know, this pressed one goes right through the patient, because that is the patient's head, and those are the shoulders, and that is the, well, it's a couch, but under the couch is the receptor. So this first set of photons passes right through the patient and interacts with the receptor. This second set of photons gets to the patient and is deviated a little. This illustration doesn't demonstrate the deviation, well, but you can at least notice that the wavelength has changed, you know, because deviation like that, the wavelength changes, the frequency changes, you know, but it still gets to interact with the receptor behind on the other side of the patient. Then we have this set that is scattered as well, but scattered so significantly over a wider angle and does not get to interact with the patient. So this and this are called scattered radiation. Now, this final one actually gets absorbed by the body. Now, they'll get absorbed by structures in the body that are in a position to absorb the photons. Now, this position to absorb the photons will depend on the, you know, atomic number of the structure in question. If, for instance, it is the ribs on a chest radiograph, it can absorb it completely because calcium has, well, calcium atomic number is 20, but that is a significant enough atomic number to enable absorption of the photon, say compared to soft tissue, you know. So this photon never gets to the receptor. That location where the photon does not get to does not show evidence that there was any interaction. The areas where of the receptor where the photon gets to, in the case of X-rays, that area turns black after development. So after the film is processed, that area where photons interacted with receptor are black. That includes photons that interacted with receptor where they should interact, and photons that interacted with receptor after being scattered. Yes, but areas where the beam or the photons are absorbed do not get to interact with the receptor. So if you are looking at, say, chest X-ray, for instance, even though we'll come to examples very soon, you know, you see areas of bone, like the ribs, like the chest thoracic vertebrae, the scapula, they are white. They didn't turn black after processing because photons heading in those directions were absorbed by the bones. However, photons heading through the lungs were largely passed through because the air in the lungs did not attenuate the photons. They passed right through and interacted. So the lungs have more areas of blackness, you know, than anywhere else. And that's how the X-ray machine looks. You all have this in your centers. You have a tube. You have what we call the bucky. The bucky, you know, contains the film and what we call the film screens that helps the image to form. And then also contains what we call a grid. The grid helps to, the grid helps to absorb scattered radiation, the type I mentioned in the previous slide, like this, so that it doesn't actually get to interact with the film. So there's a grid, and then the film, and then the screens that work with the film. Then there's the X-ray tube. For images acquired with the patient standing, the tube is simply turned in this direction. So the patient can stand, hold on to the bucky, and still take a deep breath if it's a chest radiograph. You know, but for patients that cannot stand, you know, they lie on this couch, you know, and the tube is focused downwards. The film in this case is placed underneath the couch, you know, and images are acquired. You know, the advantage of X-rays for acquiring images is that they are affordable, you know, very inexpensive. You know, most people can afford a chest X-ray or a skull X-ray, you know, or the X-ray of the limbs when a fracture is suspected. It's readily available, it's everywhere. There are several, even in small towns, several X-ray machines available, even in small towns. But you know, most importantly, the fact that X radiation is high energy ionizing radiation, you know, and we worry about deterministic health effects here, because the dose is not that bad, but we worry about stochastic health effects. These are health effects that they are not predictable. We don't really know who will be affected. The greater the dose, the greater the likelihood of a stochastic health effect. You know, once the effect has happened, further increasing of the dose doesn't worsen the effect. You just need it to happen, and then it's there, like gene mutation. like the carcinogenic effects of X-rays. So we worry about those. I'll say a little about those when we talk about the CT, which emits so much more X radiation than, say, plain X-ray images that are acquired. The second disadvantage is that, you know, this is a two-dimensional, you know, projection imaging. Every structure along the entire thickness of the body is superimposed on each other. So the film shows all the structures that can be seen, from those at the back to those in front, within that field of view, all superimposed on each other. You know, that's why it takes some training and time to be able to understand what is being seen and know what is where, because some things are obstructed by other things, and that's just how it comes, you know. Then thirdly, this modality may not provide adequate contrast. I'm going to say a few things as we go on regarding the various types of densities that you have on X-rays. But you know, with X-rays, fluid in the chest, like pleural effusion, will have the same density as the heart, you know? And when they are close together or contiguous, you may not actually know where the fluid ends and where the heart begins. You know, but they are the same density, even though they are completely different structures, you know, with different characteristics. So that brings us to this. You know, there are five densities that are seeable on X-rays. When we say densities, we're talking about whiteness or darkness on a plain radiograph. One is air. We say air density, but we are referring to absolute black color. That is, this is an area where the radiation interacts maximally with the film, and the film turns black after processing. It's black. So we say it's an air density. You see some of this in the lungs. You see some of this in the sinuses. You see some of this in the petrous temporal bone. If the mastoid air cells extend the air cells into the petrous temporal bone, of course, you see this in the mastoids. You see this in the nasopharyngeal airway, the oropharyngeal, laryngopharyngeal airways. It's dark, they contain air. So only air looks that way. Then we have fats. Fat is also dark, but not as dark as air. You will see fats mainly within the fat planes, between the muscles. You will see peritoneal fat sometimes if other structures are not superimposed on it. Then there's the soft tissue density. It's like an intermediate density, and most things, most structures fall into soft tissue density. Muscles fall into that, the heart falls into that, blood vessels, nerves, if they're there. Then fluid, water, you know, whether it's an empyema thoracic or whether it's a serous or purulent pleural effusion, they all have the same soft tissue density. Then we have the bone density. Yeah, bone absorbs a lot of the X-ray. So where bone is tends to be white, not perfectly white, but tends to be white. So the ribs are white, the skull bone, the long bones, the scapula, all bones are white. But then the whitest are metallic densities. You always have metallic densities on our radiographs because we use a metallic marker.
I see there are the people that even look for this as well. Very nice.
You will always have metallic density on the radiographs because we use metallic markers to indicate the left or the right side of the patient. And you see the metallic density is very, very white. So it's much whiter, bolder than the bone density. So all radiographs will have some, or in some cases, like say the chest, will have all of these five densities. Okay, so what we have here is a normal chest radiograph for an adult. The chest radiograph is the most frequently taken radiograph. They are taking even large numbers of people who aren't expected to have any problem. They are taken for pre-employment screening and examination, school admission screening. They are taken when people are ill. And so there are so many chest X-rays. And even with the advent of CT and MRI and other modalities that can also study the chest, you know, the chest X-ray has survived. When you have a chest X-ray, you're expected to be able to look at the lungs, look at the heart, look at the thoracic vertebrae, look at the soft tissue outside the thoracic cage, you know, like this, the breast shadows. You should be able to see the clavicles, see the scapula on both sides. But then there are things you ought to do first before, while evaluating the radiograph. You check whether the radiograph, the marker, if you look over here, there's an L that stands for left side. And this is a marker placed there by the radiographers that says that this is the left side of these patients. You know, this projection radiography, our right side is the left side of the patients. Okay, so that's left with a metallic marker. Sometimes, you know, you could have left here, and yet the heart shadow, the ventricular aspect of the heart shadow is pointing to the right side. And you begin to wonder whether this is a case of dextrocardia, you know, but once the left is placed there, the marker is placed there, and it appears not to correspond with what we are looking at, we have to send back to the, you know, radiography unit to confirm their marker. In almost all the cases, very many cases that this happens, what they tend to do is, oh, sorry, we placed the marker wrong. You know, we tend to believe them, you know, and, you know, because when there's doubts, we may need to subject the patient to fresh exposure of radiation just to be sure. We check for the marker, then we check whether the patient is rotated. Rotated is important, you know, because if this patient is rotated, it's supposed to be a PA view. But if the patient is rotated, the aortic knuckle may become more prominent. You may be misdiagnosing hypertensive cardiovascular changes. The heart may appear bigger, and the cardiothoracic ratio may increase. And all that is not real. It's just because the patient is rotated. How do we know whether the patient is rotated? Now, you look at the left clavicle, then you look at the right clavicle. Now, in the middle of the spine, you see some oval-shaped bony structures with central lucent areas. These are spinous processes seen end on. We are looking at the spinous process that is closest to the medial ends of both clavicles. We want the spinous process, if possible, to be of equal distance from the right clavicle and the left clavicle, to be in the middle of both clavicles by an equal distance. If we happen to see that the spinous process appears to be closer to one clavicle or the other, then the patient is rotated. The severity of the rotation enables us to decide whether it's wise to report the FIM or ask for a repeat. But we must check for patient rotation. Most centers, the radiographers can center properly and give radiographs that are not rotated. Then we have to know whether these patients, this chest radiograph was taken in AP, that is anterior-posterior, or posterior-anterior positions. Because, you know, the chest radiograph, if the person is strong enough and can stand, the person should walk up to the bulky. Yes, the patient should walk up to this, should walk up to this item. And patient is positioned such for a chest radiograph that he's pressed, the anterior aspect of his chest is pressed against the bulky. And the tube is posterior and emits the X-rays, the photons that will go through his back and through his body to interact with the film in the bulky. Now, when this position is done that way, we call it posterior anterior. So most radiographs, adult radiographs, are done with the patient standing, and they say posterior anterior radiograph. So we want it to be posterior anterior. If it is posterior anterior, the heart, which is located closer to the front of the chest, is close to the bulky and film during the positioning, and there will be no magnification. However, if the patient takes this radiograph anterior-posteriorly, that is, he's standing next to the bulky, but he's backing the bulky and facing the X-ray tube, the heart, which is located closer to the anterior border of the chest, is far from the posterior. So it's far from the film. And, you know, there's some magnification of the cardiac shadow in all anterior-posterior view photo radiographs. So we may be misdiagnosing cardiomegaly because it's an anterior-posterior radiograph. So we're aware of it when someone is very sick and is brought for an X-ray and is on the couch and is facing the X-ray tube, and it will be an AP thing, but we don't talk of the cardiac size at all because we know it's an anterior-posterior thing. So, but how do we know when a radiograph is brought to us, whether it was done, because it's not written on the, you know, but we still have to check whether it's AP or PA. In PA films, which is what it's supposed to be, like this one we have, you have to look at the clavicles again. The superior border of the clavicle medially should be a little bit concave upwards. Should be a little bit concave upwards. Should be a little bit concave upwards. And that signifies PA chest radiograph. The one coming after this, I can just jump to it before coming back. The superior border, superior medial border of the clavicle is a little bit convex upwards. Okay, so PA, concave upwards, AP, convex upwards. We want to be sure that the exposure factors, that is the technical bit by the radiographers, that the exposure factors are correct. That is the kilovoltage, which determines the energy that the photons for producing this radiograph have. The more energy they have, the more they are likely not to be absorbed even when there's bone. They are able to pass through and interact with the film. So if the KV is very high, here we use 70 kilovoltage, 70 highest 100 kV. But if we use say 120 kVp, the KV is very, very high and passes through the body, burning up, you know, the vascular markings, possibly burning up the ribs. And what we have on the radiograph is very, very dark lungs. You know, we can see the vascular markings. The ribs may be difficult to appreciate. What has happened is that the photons were so energized that, you know, more than the normal proportion got through the body of the patient and interacted with the film. The film is all black, especially where the lungs are. Okay, and also the milliampherage, you know, how much electricity, how many photons, because, you know, you set the milliampherage, it determines the number of photons used for producing the radiograph. So if the KVP, which is for energy of photons, is for energy of photons, the milliamperage determines the number of the photons used for the radiograph. When you have a very high milliamperage, a lot of photons coming, more than is required, and most of it is absorbed. So the radiograph appears white, a lot of photons absorbed, not reaching the film to interact with the film and give us some blackness. They are all in the body. So you have increased the dose to the patient and the image is all white, difficult to use for making a diagnosis. Now, the chest radiograph is divided into, on both sides, it's divided into an upper zone. So I'm having difficulty with my pointer. An upper zone, a middle zone, and a lower zone. That is done on both sides. These are just zones to help us, you know, place the location of a lesion that is seen. The zones don't correspond with the lobes of the lungs. We have an upper zone on both sides, from the root of the neck to the second anterior rib. That on both sides. You know, the ribs, we have the posterior ribs, then we have the anterior ribs. The anterior ribs are coming downwards and medially, you know, but these posterior ribs appear to curve upwards before coming back to the mediastinum. Okay, so the first two anterior ribs on both sides represent the upper zone. Then the second to the fourth anterior ribs represents the middle zone. And then everything else below that is the lower zone. So if we have a tuberculoma, somewhere there, this will fall into the middle zone because it's between the second anterior rib on the right and the fourth anterior rib on that same side. However, the right lung, you know, it has a horizontal fissure. It has three lobes. The shape of the lower lobes on both sides is such that a lesion located in the middle lobe, for instance, on the right side, may correspond to the apical bronchopulmonary segments of the lower lobe on that same side. But for radiographs, we just talk about zones. It's in CT that we can accurately talk about the specific bronchopulmonary segment that a lesion is located. Then we have to compare the densities of both lungs. They should be similar. They should be similar. So the right lung is dark, sort of. Yeah, the left lung should be dark as well. But one should not be darker than the other. Some technical errors in image acquisition may cause one to be darker than the other. But, you know, if one side is darker than the other, it may also be suggestive of a pneumothorax, where we have more air in that lung and in that pleural space, and we are not able to appreciate the pulmonary vascular markings. Now, what we have to compare the two lungs generally is that sometimes a pneumothorax may not jump at us. It's not something that, you know, we will always know instantly that it is there. You know, but if as a matter of routine, we compare the left lung and the right lung in terms of density, we'll gradually begin to see that when one of them is a little darker than the other, we now check whether the darker one has lost the lung markings. Then we can talk about pneumothorax. Then we go to the heart. The cardiac shadow tells us a lot about the state of the heart. We will always measure it. We measure the maximum transverse dimension of the cardiac shadow. and we compare it with the maximum transverse dimension of the thoracic cage. You know, and we call this the cardiothoracic ratio. In adults, it's about 50%. When it's more than 50%, then we are suggesting that the heart is enlarged, especially when we are sure that it's a PA radiograph. And then we start talking about whether it's enlarged with multi-chamber involvement or whether it's enlarged with left ventricular preponderance. You know, the left ventricle forms the left cardiac border. You can see the yellow arrow. The right atrium forms the right cardiac border. A little bit of the left cardiac border at the upper third or so. Even though the left ventricle forms most of it, the upper third or less is the left border of the left atrial appendage. And a little above that, we may have the pulmonary conus, but the left ventricle forms most of the left cardiac border. The right ventricle is not appreciated on the PA radiograph. We need a lateral view, which I'll show you to appreciate that. The aorta has an ascending component, and we have the arch, and then we have the descending thoracic aorta. And at the arch, on radiographs, on chest radiographs, we call this the aortic knuckle. You see, as the aorta begins to unfold in hypertensive cardiovascular changes, the aortic knuckle becomes prominent. So we're able to say, it is prominent. So we may see some other features along the border of the aortic arch, like features of atheromatous plaques and others, and may confirm to us that there might be atheromatous aortic disease. But when it's prominent, we can see it's prominent. We just have to be sure that the patient is not rotated, because once the patient is rotated, many times the aortic knuckle is prominent.
Hello. I think Dr. May has network issues. A lot of people are complaining they can't hear him. Please.
His microphone is muted. His microphone is muted.
Yes, no, I think I lost. I saw my hotspots went off. I'm trying to come back. Right, I'm sorry.
Thank you, sir.
Zoom meeting.
Okay. It's Okay, am I heard? I'm sorry, I went offline. Am I heard?
We can hear you now.
It's my voice.
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, I'm sorry. Okay, so I was talking about the costophrenic sulci and why they should be examined in every radiograph. Because when there's a pleural effusion, that's where the fluid becomes apparent. We'll notice blunting of the costophrenic sulcus on one side or the other. And it's from there that it fills up the rest of the sulcus and gets to the level of the hemidiaphragm in question and continues to grow into the lower zone, you know, with a concave upper border. Then finally, we examine the rib cage. You're looking at the ribs, you know, they don't look, they're not always clear. So they require that we look closely, you know, to be sure that there is no fracture. Among the images I have for today, there's a fracture. You'd be surprised at how, say, a single rib undisplaced fracture can be missed easily because the ribs are not always, it's not quite like CT, bone window, that shows everything so clearly. Okay. So this is a radiograph in a child that is just 6 years old. So this one was done AP, not PA. So the heart is a little bit, it's large, you know, for children of this age, for pediatric cases, we allow for 60% maximum cardiothoracic ratio. Remember, it's 50% in the men. When we talk of a transverse dimension, the widest transverse dimension of the heart being compared to the widest transverse dimension of the thoracic cage. Secondly, I had mentioned earlier that we have to look at the superior border of the clavicle. You know, you can see that this one is a little bit convex superiorly, you know, as consistent with AP radiographs. The tube, the patient is facing the tube and the receptor is behind the patient. Now, this is a lateral radiograph, a normal lateral radiograph. Sometimes we do a lateral radiograph, you know, for instance, structures like the manubrium sternum, not well appreciated on the AP. We want to see it, so we are looking at it. Sometimes they say mediastinum, and anterior mediastinal mass. We are not so sure we can appreciate it well as to where it is exactly on the PHS radiograph. External patient also, this lucency will be obscured by the retrosternal goiter. Then we have a retrocardiac lucency too. We can also call it a prevertebral lucency. You know, if we have a posterior mediastinal mass, it's lucency. Then we have the posterior costophrenic sulcus, just like we have those lateral costophrenic sulci on the PHS radiograph. The posterior costophrenic is the deepest of all the costophrenic sulci. So this is where even the most minimal amount of pleural fluid will be detected well before it is seen on the PHS radiograph. You can see that there are two hemidiaphragms. You can see this shadow for one, and you can see a denser shadow for the other. The higher one is normally the right hemidiaphragm, and the other one is the left hemidiaphragm. But you can see the costophrenic sulci, you know, the deepest costophrenic sulci. Then I also mentioned that the anterior cardiac border, which we are now seeing, because this is a lateral image, is made up of the right ventricle. The left ventricle, the border of the left ventricle is the left cardiac border, but it's also the posterior border of the heart. So the posterior border of the heart, in most parts, is made up by the left ventricle. Why that anterior border of the heart, which you cannot make out on the PHS radiograph, is the anterior, is the right, made up of the right ventricle. Now this is a normal abdominal radiograph. We may want an abdominal radiograph if we think that there's abdominal trauma, or there's a history of abdominal trauma, or some abdominal emergency, you know, intestinal obstruction, you know, perforated duodenal ulcer, you know, conditions that may give us, you know, ileus, sentinel loop of bowel, you know, dilated loop of bowel. If there's a perforated viscous, air escapes from the bowel and moves up to a position under the diaphragm on one side or the other, you know. So we don't see that in an abdominal radiograph. We'll need a chest radiograph where we can see the diaphragmatic outlines and appreciate air under the diaphragm. I have an example here in the later slides. But on the abdominal radiograph, we see air density inside the bowel loops. Now, this is large bowel. This is also large bowel. How do we know it's large bowel? It's large bowel because it is peripheral. Large bowel is usually peripheral, while small bowel tends to be central. Large bowel also shows what you call hostra. You know, on imaging, they look like septa, but they don't cross the entire thickness of the bowel, unlike the valvular connivantes that we see in small bowel when it's distended, you know. So when we have the hostra and then we have the peripheral location, we know we're dealing with large bowel. Large bowel should not be more than 5.5 centimeters in widest diameter. Small bowel, when there's gas in small bowel, we're able to see, but this is not adequate for us to measure. But small bowel should not be more than 3.5 centimeters in widest diameter. Abdominal X-ray radiograph also allows us to look at the lumbar spine. You know, we're able to look at the ala of the sacrum. We're able to look at the, you know, iliac crest on both sides. We're even able to look at the pubic symphysis and the hip joints. Normal skull radiographs, you know, skull radiographs taken when there's a head injury. It's nothing like doing a CT, but most times this is what patients will be able to afford when they are brought to hospital, you know. So on the skull radiograph, we're going to look at a cella torsica. We're going to look at a dozen cella, which is at the posterior border of the cella torsica. We can see some of the sinuses. We can see the frontal sinuses with air density inside it. So we know it's frontal sinuses. You know, we see the ethmoid, you know, the ethmoid air cells have anterior, middle, and posterior air cells, which lie in front of the sphenoid sinus. So we can also see these airfield spaces within the skull that are the sinuses. We can see this mass of irregular mass of bone. So it looks a petrotemporal bone on the two sides, superimposed on each other. We can see the sutures, some of the sutures. We can see the lambdoidal suture with this blue arrow pointing at it. And we can see the coronal sutures. They are superimposed on each other, you know. Then we notice that there's the inner and outer skull table with the deep loop between the two of them. So we have cortical bone, very dense, outside, cortical bone inside, and then the middle, you know, some bony trabeculae and, you know, hematopoietic cells, the deep loop in the middle. A skull fracture, you know, when it's very bad, is easily appreciated on the skull X-ray. You know, metastasis, lytic metastasis to the skull, you know, can be appreciated on this radiograph. Conditions like multiple myeloma will give you punched out lesions in the skull. You know, so such things can be appreciated on skull radiograph. For many of these conditions, CT has taken precedence in imaging. And so this is still a skull radiograph, but this is the AP. You know, so we're seeing the same lambdoidal suture we saw previously. We are seeing the same sinuses, the frontal sinuses, the ethmoid sinuses, those shaggy, dense petrostemporal bones. On the AP radiograph of the skull, they are usually superimposed on the orbits. You know, the tube can be angled in such a way that they fall below the orbit. But many times, when it's not angled, they are superimposed on the orbit. Then we can see the nasal turbinates. Now, there are many variations of x-rays of the skull. You know, we can have the occipitomental view when we want to look at the sinuses. The patient's head is tilted upwards, you know, for that. We can have the OF20 where we angulate the tube and then we throw out the petrostemporal bones from the orbit. So we can see the orbits, because we may want to see the orbits, okay? And so there are variations of the, there's a Schuller view where we try to look at the skull from underneath, because we're able to appreciate some structures at the skull base, the foramina at the skull base, foramen of valley, foramen spinosum and co at the skull base, which we cannot see in these frontal projections. Again, a lot of this has been superseded by CT bone window. So we talk about, we're not talking about, say, you know, pathologies in the chest on chest radiographs, because we've seen the normal chest and we know the different things that we should look out for in any chest radiograph that should all be normal. And then we say a normal chest. You know, but sometimes, you know, there are lesions in the lungs, there are lesions in the chest. In the lungs, this opacity may be homogeneous. There might be a homogeneous opacity in the lungs. You'll see examples as we move on. You know, like with patients who have pneumonic, lobar pneumonia, the consolidation may be homogeneous. In bronchopneumonia, it may not be homogeneous, but in lobar pneumonia, usually is homogeneous. A pulmonary mass lesion, a neoplasm, whether it's benign or malignant, usually be homogeneous. Conditions like tuberculoma, hematomas, lung hematoma, homogeneous. They may be small, but homogeneous. Then a pleural effusion is a homogeneous opacity, just that it's in the lower zone and it extends into the costopharynx sulcus on the ipsilateral side. An empyema is also a homogeneous opacity in the lungs. Now, there are inhomogeneous opacities that could form, and there are so many types. You know, each type is associated with certain differentials, specific differentials, you know. So we have these tricky inhomogeneous opacities. They look like lines, you know, like lines, curvilinear lines, or not usually straight. But they may be suggestive of early pulmonary infiltrates from an, you know, infective condition. And then lymphangitis carcinomatosa, you know, that's when a malignancy gets into the lymphatics, you know, and, you know, we're able to see evidence of it on chest radiographs. They have peculiar features. They could be streaky, or they could be reticular. We are coming to reticular. The next is reticular, you know, thickened interlobular septa, sort of thing we see in early fibrotic lung disease. Our reticular, reticular is like mats, the matty, the, is a set of tricky opacities, and then another set that are tangential, are perpendicular to them, so they look like mats, you know. So fibrotic changes in the lungs, thickened interlobular septa, have those features. Then inhomogeneous opacities could also be nodular. You could have solitary or multiple nodular lesions. Metastasis may give us small or large cannonballs, nodular lesions. We can have a solitary nodular lesion that's a solitary metastasis. Hematomas, tuberculomas may just be nodular. They will have small pinpoints or miliary numerous and widespread in both lungs, as you see in pulmonary tuberculosis, miliary tuberculosis, some metastasis. Then commonly in any of the pneumoconiosis, whether it's silicosis or asbestosis, we may have widespread, small, nodular, pinpoint or biliary lesions in both lungs. Then we have reticulonodular, that is reticular, those, and then nodulars superimposed on that. You know, you may get this unusual interstitial pneumonia, you know, pulmonary fibrosis, you know, a lot of fibrosis is taking place with chronic inflammation in the lungs simultaneously. You can get this in the third stage of sarcoidosis. You know, you can get this also in pulmonary tuberculosis. Then you have this ground glass inhomogeneous opacity. It's like it's faint. The opacities are faint. It's ground glass is peculiar, and it's associated with partial filling of the alveoli, you know, and distal bronchial airways, the bronchioles and the alveoli. And it's sort of things found in allergic alveolitis or just alveolitis. Then linear, just very straight opacities. That is different from streaky. We have that in plate atelectasis. We have that congestive cardiac failure on chest radiographs. So when we are looking at chest radiographs with pathology, when we see the opacity, they are either homogeneous or they are inhomogeneous. And when they're inhomogeneous, we have to really sort of make up our minds whether we're dealing with reticular inhomogeneous or reticulonodular inhomogeneous or miliary shadows, because each of these will point us in direction of, and each of these and whatever other findings we have will point us in direction of specific differential diagnosis. So this is a chest radiograph. You look at it and you see an inhomogeneous opacity at the right upper and mid zones. There are smaller versions of this inhomogeneous opacity on the contralateral side at the lower zone, and even the middle zones on the contralateral side, but the most obvious are on the right-hand side at the upper and mid zones. And you can see there are some streaky components of them. Then there are some small nodular components of them. And then there are some what we call background cystic areas, which are just air-filled pockets in the midst of inhomogeneous opacities. You know, so fibrous changes taking place look like this against a background of mnemonic changes. And the cystic areas, you know, it's like alveolar walls being destroyed, and numerous alveoli with their walls destroyed now are together and contain air. So they are air spaces, you know, in the midst of destroyed lung. This patient also has, if you look at an opacity at the right, because this is trachea. So they have an opacity at the right paratracheal area. And this opacity shows a convex outer border. There's a less prominent but similar opacity at the left paratracheal area, extending to the ipsilateral hilum. So these may be paratracheal or mediastinal lymphadenopathy. And then it's actually on both sides. The costopharyngeal sulci appear free. The bony rib cage appears intact. The cardiac size itself is normal. The trachea is sort of displaced both to the left side, and I can see it's narrowed, so it's focal narrowing before its bifurcation into the right and left bronchi. You know, so all these features put together could be suggestive of pulmonary tuberculosis, could be suggestive of sarcoidosis. These opacities with convex outer borders means that lymphoproliferative disorders should not be ruled out. They are differentials too. And then, of course, I think I mentioned sarcoidosis as a possible differential. The important thing is to identify where the lesion is, and therefore, to make up our mind what we think we're seeing, is it inhomogeneous or is it homogeneous? You know, are there cystic area, are they strands, like are there streaky opacities within them? Because all that, a lot of that suggests fibrous changes taking place against a background of mnemonic changes and alveolar wall destructions taking place. You know, the presence of hilar lymph nodes or features suggestive of them, you know, may tend to, you know, send our thoughts in specific directions. You know, normally we do not have bilateral lymphadenopathy in tuberculosis. You know, but bilateral lymphadenopathy we can have in sarcoidosis. We can have these fibrous changes taking place here, and we can also see beginning to take place on the contralateral side, maybe indicative of chronic interstitial lung disease. But because of the lymph apparent opacities, likely mediastinal opacities with convex outer borders and lymph nodes, we can't rule out lymphoproliferative disorder. So these are differentials based on what we see. Now, this is also a PA chest radiograph. And notice that this is darker than this. And this may not be a long field at all. This is likely air within the left pleural space. If you look closely, pulmonary vascular markings, as you can make out comfortably on this contralateral side. So this is a pneumothorax, and this is left lung that has collapsed and relaxed towards the hilum. So left lung collapse and pneumothorax. If you look at the costaring sulci, while this one is acute, you look at this, you notice some features of blunting of the costaring sulcus on the left side. So this may be due to pleurisy, or this may be due to minimal effusion that's developing there. Chest radiograph, PA. Now, this is a homogeneous opacity. You know, that spans the right upper mid. If you look closely within it, you may see some linear branching lucencies. You know, this happens because in lobar pneumonia, you have fluid within the alveoli. It will have soft tissue density, like say the heart. You know, but the airways leading to those alveoli still contain air, emits an area of, we call the air bronchogram sign, and is characteristic of lobar pneumonia. It may not affect the position of the heart. It may not cause tracheal deviation. It may be all that is seen. Like in this case, we don't have any features indicative of a pleural fluid collection, and the bony rib cage appears intact. You know, so a plain chest radiograph also. But then we have a homogeneous opacity within the right lower zone. In fact, it's all soft tissue density. It obscures the outline of the hemidiaphragm, the right hemidiaphragm. So we don't know where this opacity ends and where the diaphragm begins. It obscures the inferior half of the right cardiac body.
What's happening? We can't hear you again. The network. Please just hang on for him to rectify, please. You are muted, sir. Please unmute.
Okay. Yes, I think it's threatening to rain here. So periodically disrupting my network. You know, my apology again. You know, so this is a right-sided pleural effusion. The meniscus signs superiorly, the extension into the costopharynx sulcus as compared to the costopharynx sulcus on the opposite side. The effusion is fluid, but and the heart is muscle. But we can see the densities are the same. We can make out the where the fluid ends and where the cardiac shadow begins. So in fact, this the cardiac size here is indeterminate. We cannot say for sure what the size is like. We can make out the border of the right hemidiaphragm. So the opacity is just contiguous from the inferior, the lower zone on the right side, all over straight to the diaphragm. We cannot make out the difference. That's just how soft tissue opacities are. So right-sided pleural effusion. Now, this a chest radiograph too, I know it's a PA view. The patient is not particularly well positioned. I can see that the spinous process that is at the level of the medial borders of the clavicles are so close to the left clavicle compared to the large distance from the right clavicle. You know, so one can say this patient is rotated, but I doubt if the degree of rotation can account for the increased size of the cardiac shadow, which is far in excess of 50% of the transverse diameter of the chest. This cardiac shadow may appear to be increased, the multi-chamber enlargement of the heart, the right atrium appears rather prominent, the left ventricle appears prominent and appears to dip downwards. You know, the ventricle on the left side dipping downwards is it sort of confirms, you can see the apex dipping downwards. It sort of confirms left ventricular preponderance in this case of cardiomegaly. And that sort of thing we see in a hypertensive cardiac changes. The hypertensive cardiac changes, here we can see that the right costopharynx sulcus is blunted, maybe a minimal effusion is developing there. The in patients like this, they come for periodic, once in a while they will do an x-ray, we're able to compare what we have with what we had before. You know, the left ventricle begins to fail and cannot pump out the blood it receives. And then there's back pressure changes that builds up in the left atrium and then in the venous pulmonary veins taking blood to the left atrium, and eventually we start having increased hydrostatic pressure within the engorged pulmonary veins and pulmonary edema. Yeah, we are able to appreciate all these stages on a chest radiograph in people that have hypertension and it's not managed. Here we already have minimal pleural effusion on the right side. We are beginning to run out of time. I'll quicken the pace. We have a small fracture on this, where the blue arrow is located. It's not really displaced. but this is a fracture of the left posterior eighth rib. And then here, a chest radiograph showing minimal air under the right hemidiaphragm. You can make it out where the red arrow is located in a patient with perforated duodenal ulcer. Here we have an abdominal radiograph with valvular conventes visible in distended small bowel loops, obstruction of the small bowel, usually happens following adhesions, usually if there's been a previous surgery. We know it's a small bowel because of the valvular conventes, different from the ostra, that do not pass entirely through the thickness of the bowel. And here we have marked intestinal obstruction. This is a sigmoid volvulus. It has its typical features, distended bowel that converges inferiorly, overlaps the liver, and overlaps the left flank, sigmoid volvulus. An IV was just included here. So you can see a functional study where contrast is administered, and we're able to appreciate the excretion from the kidneys because we want to know whether there's normal renal function, we want to know whether the ureters are in a normal position, the bladder are in a normal position. We now have CT urography doing most of this for us. The airways in children who may have, increase in size of the soft tissue at the roof of the nasopharynx, what we call adenoids, and then increase in size of the palatine tonsils. In this case, there's still an airway at the nasopharynx, at the oropharynx, and the laryngopharynx. But in this next slide, the airway is completely obliterated. If you see, the fullness of the soft tissue of the nasopharynx is marked, and then the palatine tonsils are markedly. So this is an obstruction. The child is breathing from his mouth. And even then, there's still a problem. The oropharyngeal airway is not particularly patent. This is an angiographic study, and we can see the outline of the carotid at the neck, and we can see the carotid at the floor of the cavernous sinus and the carotid siphon. We're able to demonstrate branches of the middle cerebral artery. Angiographies like this are done to rule out aneurysms and to rule out angiomatous malformations. Radiographic artifacts. We have mentioned that patient may move during radiograph film acquisition. It causes a disruption of the image and distorts the image. There could be double exposure, there could be grid artifacts, debris in the tube housing could all disrupt the images that are produced when we examine the radiographs. When we examine radiographs and these disruptions are there, we can make wrong diagnosis, and some of the disruptions pose as pathology. So when they are suspected, we ask for a repeat. We can make out numerous lines, long lines, what we call grid artifacts, due to the grid that was badly used. We can see electrostatic shadows due to mishandling of the film, causing small sparks during storage. We don't get to know until we acquire the images and we notice these artifacts. I'll have to quickly move through CT as we're running out of time. Imaging modalities that uses x-rays and computer systems to form cross-sectional images. The CT is different from the plain radiographic image. If we take a plain radiograph, a PA view, and then we need to see some more of the chest, we do a lateral view. But the CT can take 360 views around the body. And then a computer processor uses such volume of data to prepare an axial image of that part of the body. There's a lot here, but we can't go through them one by one. But look at the image. We have the illustration here, shows the X-ray tube in the CT machine. It shows a filter and shows collimators. Then it shows the patient lying down within the gantry. So this beam goes right through the patient. And then there are hundreds of detectors located on the opposite side of the tube behind the patient. Now, this tube acquires images by passing the rays through the patient. The detectors measure the attenuation from the beam after passing through the patient. And these attenuation values from hundreds of receptors are used by a computer to process an image. The tube moves around, as you can see this arrow, and then the detectors also moving around in the opposite direction. You know, so there are views from all over the patients, maybe 300, 400, 500 views from all over the patients that are used for producing the image. That is what it looks like. The gantry has the X-ray tube inside it, and the patient lies on the couch. There are benefits in that images are acquired in a short time, you know, and excellent images are produced that provide a lot of information, damage to bones, internal organs, and other problems that may be discovered in the body with CT that cannot be made out with X-ray or ultrasound. The problem here is ionizing radiation can be as high as 50 to 7 times the exposure from a chest radiograph. So it's always a consideration when using CT. The densities on CT, you know, they are based on attenuation. So actual values are allocated to small pixels on the viewing box of the CT. It's not a projection radiography. The attenuation values for each structure of the body being imaged is represented as a white color, a gray color, or a black color, and different shades in between this. We have 4 major shades. You know, we have air that is very, very black, and we have a Hounsfield unit of 1,000 for that. We have compact bone, minus 1,000 for air. Then we have compact bone on the other side that is very, very bright or white, and we have plus 1,000, and we have values in between, with water being at the middle. 0, and it is deep gray allocated for that. So we have a variety of structures and appearances between minus 1,000 and plus 1,000. So we have acute hematoma. We should know with time which one is which by measuring the Hounsfield. The acute hematoma is 55 to 75 Hounsfield. So even though it may look white like bone, it is not actually as high as bone in terms of the Hounsfield. And if we have calcification within the brain, it may look like acute hematoma. It's also white, but on measuring it, we can see it's nearer bone than an acute hematoma. These CT images are looked at in windows. The windows just select specific ranges of Hounsfield because our human eyes cannot actually look at, say, 2,000 shades of gray, white and black. As the images are acquired, we can't appreciate the contrast between different structures with such minor differences in Hounsfield. So we use windows. We have a brain window where the brain is gray, with certain areas of the gray being darker gray than others because they contain fats. Where CSF is dark, as CSF within the lateral ventricles. We have a bone window that makes the bone not so white. So we can see the deep blue within it, and we can appreciate fractures when they are there. You know, this is still bone window at a higher level than this. You know, we can look at bone window side by side with brain window for the same patients. Here there's a fracture that is at the right temporoparietal region. We may not see it very well on the brain window, but that's why the bone window is there. And then we have a small acute subdural bleed at the left frontoparietal region, which is not featured on the bone window. That is how we view CT in different windows. We know what we expect to see in a brain window, what we should see in a bone window. Now, this is an acute epidural bleed. We know it is acute epidural bleed because it is biconvex. And it's acute. It is hyperdense. The moment it's subacute, it starts getting darker. Hemosiderin. we can see the effect of a bleed in the brain. It compresses the lateral ventricle on that side and displaces the midline to the contralateral side. We can see a subdural bleed. It doesn't look like the acute epidural bleed. It looks crescentic and not biconvex. Here it has a dark area and white area. So this may be an acute component on a chronic, so the person may have had it before and bled fresh into it. This is subdural bleed, crescentic features, also with mass effect. This is an intracerebral bleed, the sort of bleed that we have in hemorrhagic stroke in patients with hypertension. This is located in the thalamus and lentiform nucleus on the left side. Some of it has gotten into the ventricle. We know this is hyperdense. It looks like the bone, but it's not like the bone. Measurement of this will show HU of 55 to 75, while bone is plus 1,000. You know, we can give contrast to a patient who we think we are seeing something on the brain window, a mass lesion, but we are not sure. We give contrast, and then the lesion takes up so much contrast, and we can see it's an extra axial lesion. This is a meningioma. It causes mass effects. This is how it is without contrast. A bleed will not be like this without contrast. This is almost the same density as the rest of the brain without contrast. So the subsequent images are simply normal images of the chest post-contrast in both long window and mediastinal window. On long window, we're able to see the blood vessels within the lungs, which we are not able to appreciate on mediastinal window. That applies at a higher cut. Abdominal slices. Mediastinal window, yes, but in abdominal imaging on CT, we do the imaging in arterial phase after contrast, then venous phase after contrast, and delayed phase. We do it that way because the liver receives most of its blood during the venous phase, portal venous period. Tumors receive most of the blood to enhance during the arterial phase, and the delayed phase is so that we can see contrast leaving the ventricle, leaving the kidneys as they are being excreted out. We will not appreciate that in the arterial and venous phases. These are just images following in coronal view as opposed to the axial view. That is VTO CT. This is a CT of the chest in long window. And we can see widespread reticular opacities. This patient has a virtually destroyed lung, chronic interstitial lung disease, sort of thing seen on X-ray, but seen better on CT. We can see pneumothorax, no pulmonary markings, but we can see part of the lung that has collapsed. Same here at the apex of the lung. We can see a small bleb within the lung that ruptured into the pleural space, giving this pneumothorax. CT artifacts, just like X-ray artifacts, they are of different types. And we can see evidence of artifacts disrupting the image. This is what they call a beam hardening artifact. And it is what they call a detector imbalance artifact. This is from the equipment itself. It fails, and we have some anomalies on the images acquired. MRI, this is an imaging modality that uses non-ionizing radiation and magnetic fields and computer systems to create useful diagnostic images. I crave indulgence to leave the physics because the slides are available to you to look at. So I can show you some of the images quickly because of time. That's the MRI machine. Now, this is a T1-weighted image. T1-weighted images, you're going to have CSF and anything like water, dark. You're going to have air, dark. And you're going to have fats, like fat in the subcutaneous tissue, hyper-intense. That is different from T2-weighted images, where you're going to have fluid, all fluid, white. We call it hyper-intense. So the ventricles, white. The salt side, the CSF surrounding the salt side and within the salt side, white. However, the subcutaneous tissue is also hyper-intense, just like in T1 with the images. We have a popular flare image, which allows us to see images looking like the T1 with the images. But when there's an abnormality like inflammation or abnormal fluid, like there's a case of gliosis, it is hyper-intense. It's called a flare imaging. It's acquired in one of the sequences in all images. Then, of course, contrast images. We have contrast administered on MRI only occasionally. The contrast images show contrast-filled blood vessels. But you see, MRI is peculiar in that there's much we can achieve with the knobs without actually giving contrast. We can acquire images using what they call GRE sequences, which is mentioned in the physics, without giving contrast. MRI is excellent for brain and spine. So again, on T2-weighted spinal images, CSF is white. The nucleus pulposus in the spine is hyper-intense, while the annulus fibrosis is dark. But if you go to T1-weighted, the same CSF is dark. And then the nucleus pulposus is darker than on T2-weighted. It contains fluid and gelatin, and then the annulus fibrosis is dark. So this is just an coronal image, you know, similar to the ones I've shown you that are sagittal. And this is an axial image. We can see cysts in the kidney in this hyper-intense area. The CSF is hyper-intense, so we know this is a T2-weighted image. And then the cysts in the right kidney are hyper-intense. Blood flowing on MRI usually is signal void. That is, it is dark. There's the reason for that is in the physics that is in the earlier slides. On T1-weighted and T2-weighted, subcutaneous tissue is fat, so it's usually hyper-intense. Then there are artifacts on MRI, just as mentioned for CT and for X-rays, and they are all due to effects affecting the physics underpinning the function of the MRI. And the two that stand out, the disruption of the normal magnetic field by substances that may be in the body, or by a disease condition, or by things like hemosiderin that have a paramagnetic effect in the brain, like in the, as in this case, they suddenly show you these dark areas that are, that may look alarming, but they are artifactual, they are not real, you know? And then we have what they call the wraparound artifacts. You know, that is the field of view selected by the radiographer. What he was imaging is beyond that field of view. So the remaining structures wrapped around to still accommodate themselves in the image, it disrupts the entire image. That's about it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Eric Ume. We appreciate your lecture this evening. We have come to the end of the lecture, and now it's time for questions and comments. Please, if you have a question, you show by a lift of the hand. And if you have dropped your question on the chat box, it's going to be addressed. So while waiting for people to indicate by lift of the hand, we'll take the questions on the chat box. I think I've seen Dr. Dani.
Dania.
Yeah, good Dr. evening. Dania. All right, please, you have the floor. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Prof, for that erudite lecture. My question is, what view of the skull X-ray best demonstrates a pituitary enlargement? Thank you.
Okay. The skull X-ray. Usually the lateral view. Let me get back to where we are there. You know, remember the pituitary is a soft tissue structure. So the lateral view of the skull shows us the cella where the pituitary lies. And then we're able to infer that the pituitary gland is enlarged, because we see widening of the cella tussica. We know that the AP dimension of this cella tussica is about 11 to 16 millimeters. So if it looks deformed, looks wider, longer than it should be, we know that there must be a structure inside it that has grown in size. So pituitary macroadenomas will widen the cella. We'll need to use a CT and MRI to look at the actual enlarged organ. But the X-ray will show us changes in the bone, the shape of the bone, widening of the bone, possibly calcification in the area to make us imagine that there's an enlarged pituitary. You know, other conditions like cranial pharyngioma may give such features on the X-ray. Rat case cleft cysts may give such features on the X-ray. We confirm enlarged pituitary gland using CT or MRI. I hope that sort of answers.
Yes, thank you, sir.
We also have Dr. Mike, your hand is up. Please, you have the floor to ask your question.
Yeah, thank you, Ma. Thank you, sir, for the presentation. My network went off when you were talking about the hematoma on CT. So I want to, how can we differentiate subdural, epidural, and subarachnoid hematomas?
Please do hold on. I think Dr. May has some issues with his network. He'll be back soon.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good evening, everyone. Can we move on with other things while we are waiting for me? Because our day is fast spent. We've had a wonderful session. Dr. Deity, please. While we are waiting for him, can we move on? Thank you. With other things.
Maybe Dr. Ranusi should continue with the moderation.
Yes, please. I think the question and answer, we have to narrow it down because of the time. This is a very wide topic. It's difficult to finish everything within this time allotted to him. I think we can move with other things while he comes
yes,
back.
Yes, we should.
And
I
then
said
we can read some of the questions from the chat box. Madam President.
Yes, can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can
Madam
hear
President.
You.
Yes, good evening, everyone. I know you agree with me that this is a very extensive subject, which in fact is dealt with on a full day session in some workshops, CT scan, MRI, and radiological sessions. And this speaker has actually done a very good job. So we would await him to respond to the remaining question. But while we are doing that, I want us to just recognize our mama in the house, Mama Elegbe, who has been with us all through this session. And we appreciate you, Ma. Do you have a word for us? Welcome, Ma. I hope she's still on board. The last time she was with us, she left before the end of the session. Hello, Ma. We want a word from you. Oh, okay. All right. While we are waiting for her, Professor Elizabeth Nwaso, the former NSA president, is also here. I hope she's still here too. Of course, this webinar session is her pet project, so we want her to also give us a word. Professor Elizabeth Nwaso, are you still there?
Hello, good evening, Madam President.
Yes.
Thank you. Well, it's been a very good evening, well spent. I think that the subject matter has been trashed very, very, in very great detail. And the questions too are very interesting. I just want to thank everybody for being here. Thank you, Madam President. And thank you, Dr. Deity, and the team for the good job so far. I'm grateful. Have a good evening.
Thank you, Madam.
Hello.
Hello. Yes, ma.
Good evening.
Yes, ma. Welcome, ma.
Yeah, thank you very much.
I'm happy to have you.
I touched something I shouldn't touch, but I'm back to you now.
You can
okay,
hear
ma,
me.
Thank
can
you.
Okay.
We're always happy to have you. Yeah. The last time we saw you, the next moment you had gone. So we don't want you to go today. We want you to give us a word of encouragement, ma,
yeah,
an admonition. Thank you, ma.
I think it's been a very, very well-presented topic. And I like the way he started by going very basic and walking us through terminologies. It is very important to know something is opaque, something, you know, all these terminologies that it was said, streaks or strikes of something showing fibrosis. I think we should note those things, languages that he's using, the phraseology, because some of the problems we have with you guys is that you want to explain opacity, for instance, you will go around about three sentences trying to say it's lighter or darker instead of saying opacity definitions. I think we should take note of it. And it's been a very brilliant presentation, and I commend him. Well done. Can you hear me? Am I still on? Hello, hello, hello.
We can hear you, ma.
Oh, okay. Now, one important thing I also want to say is that when you are confronted with an X-ray, don't go straight to making a diagnosis. Describe what you see. Very important. And he did that for us very beautifully well, you know, giving us, you can see he didn't go on diagnosis. He went on interpretation of the pictures or what you saw. So it's very important to take that technique when you are given an X-ray and you are asked to interpret it. You go first of all by what you see. Is there an opacity there? Is it bilateral? Is it unilateral? And so on. Is it left or is it right? And so on. Before now, you now say the diagnosis. If you can make a diagnosis, it's not really important making the diagnosis. It's what you see. And you can recognize that is appreciated. Like you can see what he said to even the experts find it difficult in some places to distinguish whether it is one thing or the other. But obviously you are going to be given very, very obvious things in the exam. Well, thank you very much. God bless you all.
I think, Prof, while we wait, if you can check the chat box, there are a few questions there, and pick some and maybe respond to them while we wait.
Yes, there's one that was on before I lost network. You know, I was asked, how do you differentiate between the different types of bleeds in the brain on CT? And it's an important question. The bleeds look different when they are epidural, when they are subdural, and when they are intracerebral or intraparenchyma. It's just for us to remember that the epidural bleeds are biconvex in shape. They are biconvex because they are limited by the sutures. So they can be limited by the coronal and sagittal suture. They can't expand in that direction. So they can only expand into the brain. So they are biconvex. They can kill quickly. So they are almost always acute. That is, they are almost always hyperdense or white like this, because that, this represents acute. That is 55 to 75 HU. So epidural is biconvex. However, subdural is crescentic. It's not convex. It's like saying
concave is concave inside, but convex outside. But we prefer to say crescentic. So what you have on the screen now, this was extradural or epidural blade, and this is subdural. It's like the, it's shaped like the moon. It's not limited by sutures. So it can actually extend from one side of the brain and anteriorly to the same side of the brain at the back. And it's concave convex. If it is a new bleed, it will be hyperdense as well, because acute is bright. But sometimes, because this can be chronic, sometimes it becomes a chronic bleed and it's now dark or hypodense. But the person can bleed again into that same subdural, as has happened in the example that I used in this. So it now becomes an acute chronic subdural hematoma. But the shape is what's important, it's crescentic. Now, intraparenchymal, it can be inside the cerebral hemisphere. It can be inside the brain stem. It can be inside the cerebellum. But intraparenchymal, if it's new, it will be hyperdense, just like the example on the screen right now. That's HU55 to 75. It can extend into the ventricular system, like the example we have on the screen. We can see that the glomus and occipital horn of the left lateral ventricle is also white, like the bleed. So the bleed extended into it. So it's normally irregular when it's intraparenchymal. It is biconvex when it's epidural, and it is crescentic when it is subdural. That's the answer to that particular question. Okay, I'm having difficulty accessing the questions in the chat. Okay. Yes, the question, one question here is the slides will be shared. Someone's asked whether the slides will be shared. Yes, the slides will be shared by the organizers.
Can the moderator please read out the remaining questions so we can round up quickly? Dr. Nsese, are you there?
Yes, ma'am, here.
Okay, all please, right. Are there more questions?
Yeah. Yes, we had a question from Modupe Ogunsina. Are there other ways to differentiate PA from AP view?
He
said he could not appreciate the curvature as explained, curvature of the clavicle as explained. Hello, sir. Please, am I being heard?
Yes, loud and clear. But there are network issues here and there from my side.
Okay. Do I go over the...
But I think that one, too, in the beginning, he was methodical. He has explained that thing. But I think he will recap if he gets the question now. For now, I think he's having some problem.
Okay, my dear chair and president-elect, I think we should compile the questions and send them to him. Our technical officer, Mr. Emeka, please take note of this, get all the questions saved. We'll send to him because our time is really fast spent. People have tried being part of this and exercised a lot of patience for this wonderfully delivered lecture. So, Dr. Deti, please, can you round up with whatever we have for subsequent days? I'm not sure we have anything next, but please, can you address the house? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam President. Unfortunately, we can't take all the questions now because of time. This is a very, very wide topic, which we'll have split it into two, but that means having the speaker coming twice. It's not that easy to sacrifice time like that. But we thank him immensely and God bless him. He is truly one of us. He's the son of our mentor, late Professor Beatrice Bume, for those who don't know him. So he is one of us. So I'm sure he'll be available to us anytime we ask him to assist us. Thank you very much, Professor Ome. Next week, it will be Sunday again, because you know the election has been postponed, and yesterday was supposed to be election for governorship. So that's why the webinar was hosted today on Sunday. But next week, unfortunately, we'll have to go Sunday again. I've spoken to the speaker and the moderator. So it will be same time next Sunday, and that will be on statistics, basic principles. That is what we have for next Sunday. Thank you very much.
Dr. Shelley, please, can you make your quick announcements? Thank you. Administrative announcements, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Matt. Good evening, everybody. And thank you very much for supporting us in this webinar. I just want to thank those who have paid their dues for this year, and also to encourage those of us who are yet to pay to please kindly pay. And we've advertised the various platforms via which you can pay your dues. And please follow us on our social media handles. And then on our YouTube, all this presentation will be uploaded as soon as the recordings are made available for your consumption. Thank you very much.
On that note, I want to thank everyone. Next week will be the West African College of Surgeons Conference. Some of us will be there. So I wish us a safe journey and useful deliberations. And I pray that God will be with every one of us. Good night. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye-bye, everyone.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Good night.
Thank you. Bye.